Last class we are discussing about berthing structures inside the harbor, either a artificial harbor or a natural harbor. But we have what is known as offshore berthing structures. That means the environment will not be protected, but we may build it in offshore exposed to sea condition. This may not be all weather. All weather means not all the 365 days, maybe for 270 days or so, and mainly this is used for larger vessels. Larger vessel means 0.1 to 0.3 million tons, typically about 0.3 million ton DWT vessel, that is about 22-23 meter draft. In India we have this type of facilities using a single buoy mooring system in Vadinar in the Gulf of Kutch to handle VLCCs. That was the first structure which was built. Like that we have many single buoy mooring systems. Then we have a approach trestle for a long distance, maybe 7 or 8 kilometers, then berthing and mooring dolphin. This is being built in Dahej, Gulf of Cambay, for liquid cargo. Mainly this is used for liquid cargo, but it also can be used for dry cargo, mainly for iron ore, coal, sugar, phosphates or grinds. In Australia, Indonesia and other places we have these offshore berthing structures, but mainly these structures are built for a single type of cargo, that is only one type of cargo. If it is for liquid, it is for only crude oil. If it is dry cargo, if it is designed for iron ore, it is only for iron ore. Rapid loading and unloading rates. The unloading loading rates is generally about 1500 tons per hour, but here it may go even up to 4000 tons per hour. And you should need sufficient storage offshore, and main problem is it is open sea and is exposed to winds, wave and currents. So current is also predominant in Gulf of Cambay. And another is construction practicability, whether we can build the structure. One of the problems associated with the offshore berthing structure is, I told you the top level of the structure is high tide level plus there is a gap from the water surface to the bottom of the deck. Whereas in the open sea offshore berthing structure, the top level can be plus 20 meters. Plus 20 means it is about 6 story height above the lowest water level. In Dahej and all, the top level is plus 20. In Nagapattinam, we have a offshore berthing structure for Chennai Petroleum Chemicals Limited, CPCL. The top level is plus 11. See, adjacent Nagapattinam port, the top level is only plus 4, whereas here it is 7 meter more. This is to take care of the waves which are breaking on the structure during this type of cyclones, storms and things like that. So this goes up to about 25 meter water depth for larger vessels. Nagapattinam it is only up to 12 meter water depth. Even then 8 meter waves will come. So when a 8 meter wave comes above the high tide level, you have to provide sufficient clearance, that is why it is there. So we will discuss about this offshore berthing structure separately with the figures for a single buoy mooring system as well as a approach trestle with berthing dolphins. But these structures can be built only if the cargo to be handled is very huge, maybe more than 10 million tons of cargo at a berth. Now we have to see what are all the factors governing the selection of berthing structure. This is very important. What type of structure you can choose depends on the purpose of the berth, whether it is loading, unloading, type of cargo, average soil type below the seabed, deadweight tonnage of the vessel, tidal levels, the average level of rock, where the piles can be found at. So these are the factors which will govern. So we will discuss this when you choose for a typical situation, a berthing structure. The selection depends on the magnitude and nature of loading. This we will see in the next lecture. Hydraulic conditions such as wave action and currents. And the relieving platforms, it is a combination of open type and fill type construction. These to provide uplift resistance, thereby improving the lateral road resistance of the piles. So we will discuss with the example. For bulk cargo berth, open type constructions with approach trestle is preferable. mainly the soil conditions will have an important bearing on the type of dog selected. So it depends mainly on the soil condition, what type of structure that is to be preferred. And there are certain provisions that you have to follow. Mainly the design has to be carried out as per IS 456. Discuss in the next slide about the type of design which you will carry out. The minimum grade of concrete is M30. 30 means 30 megapascal is the compressive strength of concrete cube. Minimum cement content should be 400 kg per cubic meter. 50 kg is one bag of cement, minimum 8 bag of cement. It can be more than this, it should not be less than this. This to ensure the durability. Then the maximum water cement ratio should be 0.45. That is, if you reduce the water cement ratio, your grade of concrete will improve. But to take care of workability, we need higher quantity of water. But if the water is increasing, durability will be a problem. I will discuss separately. M30 defines the strength. Durability, I will discuss separately. To ensure durability, you should have lesser water cement ratio. And to increase the durability, we have to increase the cover thickness. For slab, we have to provide 40 millimeters, beam 50 millimeters, pile 65 millimeters. This is a general guideline. But if you go to IS 456, they give for different exposure condition, what is the cover to be provided. So all these things you have to specify while doing the construction. And there are different types of cement. What is normally used is ordinary Portland cement, but it is preferable to use a blast furnace slag cement. This is again to ensure the durability. But if you use a ordinary Portland cement, you have to provide a higher grade than required from the strength consideration alone. That is what is specified in IS 4651. That means M30 grade is specified for the strength calculations. If you use blast furnace slag cement, you can use M30. But if you use a ordinary Portland cement, you have to use M35. That is what is specified. Many people do not follow that. Then the cover also depends on four zones. One is atmospheric zone, that is above the splash zone and where direct wave or spray imprisonment is infrequent, that is slightly above the high tide level, that is atmospheric zone. Splash zone is where there is a water level variation, where there is a waves splashing, there the cover should be higher. When there is a continuous seawater immersion, we can put 75 mm from 0.5 meter below lowest astronomical tide to the seabed level. Below the seabed level, we can put 50 millimeter. The provision is, we are having a pile, the cover need not have to be uniform, but generally we provide uniform cover of 75 millimeters. But what they say is, above the splash zone and below the seabed, we can reduce the cover to 50 millimeters. What is the implication of cover in the design? Is there any implication?
Corrosion.
Design, I am asking.
To improve the movement carrying capacity.
Yeah, if you have a lesser cover, the movement carrying capacity will be increased. To take care of that, we can reduce the cover. That is why we can see, you can say why we can provide 75 mm throughout. You can provide, it will restrict the corrosion. But if you provide a lesser cover for the same diameter of the pile, the movement carrying capacity will be higher. That is why you provide a lesser cover. There are two methods which are used for the design. One is called as the working stress design, another is called as the limit state design. Earlier people are using working stress method, nowadays they are using limit state method. This design is based on linear stress strain relationship within the elastic limit. The structure is designed for working loads, checked for permissible stresses. So I request all of you to go through the slide. I told, if some question is asked, you have to answer. The answer is like this. Working stress, you design it for the working loads. There is a dead load, you design it only for the dead load. We do not increase the load. And we take the stress strain relationship to be linear. But stress strain is not linear, it is non-linear. But you take it up to the elastic limit. And you check it along the permissible stresses. Permissible stresses is, there is a M30 grade of concrete. What is the permissible axial compressive stress? M30 means it fails at 30 megapascal. What is the permissible axial stress?
1/4 of sigma c.
Permissible bending compression?
1/3.
Permissible bending compression is 1/3. And permissible direct compression is less than that, it may be 75% or 80% of that. So, M30 megapascal means the strength of the material is 30, it fails only at 30 megapascal, but we take the permissible direct permissible bending compression as 1/3 of that, that is 10 megapascal. That means in that range it will be linear, and the elastic limit we are considering as 1/3 of crushing strength, okay. But limit state, we want to design it to stand all the loads liable to act on it throughout its life. There is a mistake here, throughout its life. That means we assume the load as probabilistic, we assume the return period of the load and trying to find out how much is the load. Suppose we assume that the load acting on the structure is x for a return period of 50 years, the load may be around 1.2 times x. If it is 100 years, it may be 1.5 times x. So, depending on the return period, we can increase the load, and it also has to satisfy serviceability requirement, that is both deflection and cracking. This is what we do. But one thing is, we check for permissible stress. The permissible stress, what we are assuming is the yield stress divided by 1.5, that is, if it is 30 megapascal, we assume that it can go up to 30 by 1.5, that is 20 megapascal. If it is steel, it is 415 megapascal divided by 1.15. Is it clear? Here it is only 1/3, whereas here what we are assuming is 0.67, 2/3 we are assuming for concrete. For steel it is 1 by 1.15, that is 0.87. So, the limit state method, the factor what is given is different for steel, different for concrete. The load factor what is assumed depends on the type of load. If it is active earth pressure or differential water pressure, the load factor is 1.2. If it is dead load, live load, crane load, the load factor is 1.5. If it is a wave load, it depends on the return period of the load. So, I have given three different methods to estimate the load factor. One is depending on the type of the load, active earth pressure or differential water pressure, this will not increase enormously. That is 1.2 is the maximum load factor. If it is a live load, it can be 1.5. If it is a wave force, it depends on the return period, what you are assuming. Serviceability requirements is without any load factor, you do the analysis, try to get the deflection and cracking. Here there is no load factor. For serviceability requirements, there is no load factor given from the given to the load in limit state method. Just like working stress method only, we do not give any load factor. You calculate the deflection and crack width and check whether the deflection and crack width are within the limits. Deflection is span by 350, crack width is between 0.1 to 0.3 millimeters. We check these two cases. So, this is what we have to do in limit state method. This is for concrete structures, for steel structures it is different. Another important parameter is expansion gap. This expansion gap varies. Suppose you have a 300 meter long structure, some places like Tuticorin we have built without any expansion gap, at other locations at every 60 meter intervals you have to provide the expansion gap, and depends on the type of structure, there is a open type structure or a solid type of structure. Again, it depends on the type of soil. Over a length of 300 meters, if you make 5 boreholes, each 4 holes gives a different type of soil, then you provide for each borehole location one block, because the type of soil is different. It happens in pore layer, every 50 meter the rock level varies, sometimes even every 30 meters. At first borehole the rock is at minus 15, second borehole the rock may be at minus 30, third borehole it is minus 12. So, we cannot penetrate the pile very deep into rock. So, in that case we have to give the expansion gap. Then deflection during earthquake, there is no permissible deflection for earthquake, but when earthquake happens, when there is a deflection, you should provide sufficient expansion gap. So previous slide I told about deflection. Deflection is not checked for all the load combinations. If you want to check for expansion, if you want to check the deflection for earthquake span by 350, or if you want to check the deflection for berthing force, it may not be possible because the forces are very heavy. This occurs once in a while. If you want to restrict the deflection, the cost will be very high. Deflection is checked only for permanent loads, dead load, live load, earth pressure, differential water pressure, not for occasional loads like berthing force, mooring force and all. But expansion gap you have to check for earthquake, otherwise one block with collide with another block. The expansion is also calculated considering the limit state of serviceability load combination. The crane track shall be designed suitably at expansion joint. This is another important thing. Suppose you provide more gap at the expansion joint, when the rail is moving, when the rail is placed and the crane is moving at the expansion gap, there should not be any problem. So you have to design it suitably. So this design is very important. It is expansion gap. This is a typical passenger berth. You can see the top level is higher. People can go down like this also, or there can be a ladder also here like this. Then we have a cargo berth. Here we have the cranes. Here you are seeing there is a crane rail on the sea side, there is another crane rail on the land side, and this crane, there are two cranes. This is one crane, this is the second crane. This crane is operating on this hatch, the other crane is operating on the other hatch. So that simultaneously you remove from the forward as well as aft end, otherwise it will tilt. So we need two cranes. Each crane is having two rails, sea side rail and land side rail. Each rail we have two legs, so totally we have four legs. So human beings two legs, cranes are having four legs. Each leg typically has six wheels, sometimes they may have 12 wheels also. The spacing between the wheels is about 1 meter center to center, and this is pollution free. They pulverize it and suck the cargo, there won't be any pollution in this. In some of the ports if you see, they will openly remove the cargo, that is not desirable. This is called as a hatch cover. The hatch cover has to be removed and then they will take the cargo out like this. It can be used for both loading as well as unloading. You have to take care of the loads due to this. You should provide sufficient space also for the crane to move. Typically the rail spacing is about 12 meters, it can go up to 30 meters for container cranes. This another example is a bulk cargo or a ore berth which I have taken. Here this is the ship and you have the hatch cover. The crane is in the ship itself. Called as a self geared vessel. So you take the cargo from the ship and then put it on a chute here through which it can go to a tipper and it can directly move out. So this is the bucket which is used to grab the cargo and put it here. This is the berth. The crane is not on the berth, the crane is on the ship itself. It is not that all bulk cargo or ore berth will have the self geared vessels. It can be of this type or this type. This is generally used for smaller vessels, 30,000 DWT vessel. This is used for bigger vessels. This is a typical container berth. This photograph is taken from Jawaharlal Nehru Port. This is the berthing face. There are approaches here. There is a high mast tower here. The vessels will be having containers, maybe 3 stacks or 4 stacks or 6 stacks in the vertical direction. This is the arm, so we can lift the container, take it here and drop it to the waiting truck. The waiting truck will move away. What you are seeing here is a construction which is going on for the extension, and here you can see the color difference here. So the water level can go up to this if it is fully loaded. When it is partially loaded, the vessel will go up and up. When it is going up and up, this top should not hit the top of the crane. So this height will be typically about 30 meters, because to take care of the freeboard of the vessel plus number of the containers which is there. This width is in this particular port is about 20 meters or 22 meter or so. That means this will be more than 30 meter, this may be around 40 meter or so. And the containers will be on top of the deck. Deck will be covered with the hatch cover. The hatch cover is removed and placed here. So some hatch cover from the ship, they have removed the cargo, then they removed the hatch cover, kept it here, and they take the cargo below the deck top also, and then put it on the truck, and then they move away. And this shows the fender. So the water level taken at this time is low tide level, so the fender board is not touching the bottom water level, but when the water level rises it may come up to this. So we have to take care of the fender design adequately. These are the mooring lines which are connected together. This is a liquid cargo berth. There will be marine unloading arms at the center. This is called as a mooring dolphin, berthing dolphin. So they will take the cargo from the middle and then take it out. This is called as a catwalk, which is connecting between the bollards. The ship may be connected to this mooring dolphin as well as this dolphin also. The bollard is at the middle of the mooring dolphin. So these are the different types of berth which you have to design. These are isolated dolphins. This is a continuous berth, and this berth is located far away from the coastline, because we want to reduce the dredging. This berth is very close to the breakwater. This passenger, this cargo berth also can be parallel to the breakwater or the navigation waterway. Here you have the access to the city very close by. And this portion is the width of the structure, which is designed for heavy loads. This is the backup area. So we will be discussing about design of this portion, which is called as the apron. So we will go to the next part of the lecture. This is one of the very important lectures which you have to study. This is on the loads. What you are seeing in the figure is the container stacking yard, where we have the tire mounted cranes which are used to stack the containers at different locations. This is far away from the berth. This is a stacking yard what you have to design. Here what you are seeing is some storage tanks which are used for liquid cargo vessels, liquid cargo storage. So these are the different storage that are required: a storage tank for liquid cargo, a container stacking yard with tire mounted key cranes which are used for picking up the containers. What are the forces that are acting on a berthing structure? All of you know dead load. It is weight of the structure. Live load, it can be uniformly distributed load or a crane load. Berthing force, mooring force, wave force, current force, out of which the berthing and mooring force is due to the ship. The berthing force is due to acceleration of the ship. Mooring force is due to the waves, currents and wind acting on the vessel. Wave force can be on the structure itself, current force can be on the structure itself. That means the wave and current force can act on the ship. Wave, current and wind is missing, wave, current and wind may act on the ship, and then they can create mooring force. There is a wind force that can come under live load, it can act on a crane, from that it can give you a horizontal load. The current force can act on the structure itself. wave force also can act on the structure, that means the piles are caissons. Then we have the seismic force, then active earth pressure and differential water pressure. These are the various forces that are listed, which are to be estimated for each individual structure and given as an input for an analysis and design. So, this we will discuss how to estimate all these forces. I will give you an overview in this class, then in subsequent classes I will tell how to calculate each force separately. We can classify the load as extreme, normal or temporary. Extreme means it is during storm or cyclone or tsunami, typically with a 100 year return period. Tsunami return period is not 100 years. In Indian context, tsunami return period is about 500 years. Once in 500 years only we get a tsunami. It may not be at the same coast, different coast. So, storm and cyclone we have to consider 100 year. 100 year means once in 5 years you can have a storm or cyclone, but once in 100 years the intensity will be very high. So, that you have to take care. Normal means during operation of a structure with 1 year return period. This is a normal load. 1 year return period means suppose you take the wave height, you record for 1 year, take the data. For typical Chennai coast, the 1 year return period wave height may be about 3 meters. For 100 year return period, it may be about 9 meters. If you take 1000 year return period, it may be around 10 meters. Is it clear? The load factor is different for extreme case and normal case. When you do a limit set of design, for an extreme case, the load factor is different from normal case. That is why you want to classify. Then temporary, that is during construction stage, including construction live load. This is for the temporary. Many failures that take place, it takes place during construction. This is very difficult to understand, but most of the failures, if at all it has to take place, it takes place during construction itself. I showed one example where one structure has collapsed. It has not collapsed during construction, but during dredging it has collapsed, even if it is done before put to use. Either during dredging or during construction, the collapse will take place, but 90% only, 10% during operation also will take place. So, most of our codes do not give weightage to temporary load structure. Nobody does the design also, but for harbor structure, construction period is very crucial. So, we are introducing this temporary loading as an important loading. I will explain what is temporary loading. During construction, there will be a lot of loads that are to be considered. So, we have to use that as an yardstick for the design. Is it clear classification? I will be giving two or three types of classification. One depend on the return period of the structure. Return period is 100 year return period for extreme, 1 year return period for normal. Temporary, there is no return period, it is during the construction period. Maybe for during the construction, suppose a gantry is moving for driving the piles, the construction period may be 15 days, then you have to take that load during that time. The other type of classification is where the load is coming from. Whether the load is coming from the seaside, it is coming from the top of the deck, or it is coming from the land side. The berthing force and mooring force are from the seaside. Active earth pressure and differential water pressure are from the land side. Crane load is from the deck. Seismic force can be in any direction. It can come from the sea, it can come from the land, it can come from the top, left to right, diagonal, any direction. What are the loads from the seaside? These include the horizontal forces. We have to talk the loads in two categories. One is the horizontal force, another is the vertical force. The horizontal forces are caused by the waves, the forces caused by the berthing and vessels pull from the bollard. These are the forces from the seaside. The forces caused by the berthing vessels are determined from the velocity and angle of approach of the vessel. Basically, it depends on the square of the velocity, and for that we have to take care of the mass of the vessel also. The vessels lying at the berth, the forces are determined due to wind, waves and currents on the vessel. This for the mooring forces, we have to find about the wind, wave and current. Wind also, we can have normal wind and extreme wind. In case of extreme wind, we remove the vessel from the berth. We do not keep the vessel at the berth. We do not design for all the cases. We specify a wind velocity. If we say about 20 meter per second is the permissible velocity, when the wind speed becomes more than 20 meter per second, we give the instruction to the vessel to move it away from the berth. Load from the deck. The important loads are the vertical loads. These are caused by the self weight of the deck. Superimposed loads from buildings and handling equipment. And this also consists of horizontal loads. They are mostly due to wind on buildings and structures, and also due to breaking forces of cranes. So, we have both vertical load as well as horizontal load. The vertical loads are weight of the deck, superimposed loads from buildings and handling equipment, and the horizontal load is due to wind acting on the crane or on the building. It can be lateral and longitudinal, and it also can be a braking force. When the crane is moving, suddenly apply a brake, due to that there is a longitudinal traction. That also will give you the braking force. Loads from the land side, they are caused by the earth pressure and differential water pressure. The vertical loads are caused by the weight of the filling and superimposed load on the filling. So, from the land side, you can have both horizontal loads as well as vertical loads. The horizontal loads are due to earth pressure and differential water pressure. The vertical loads is due to surcharge load that is coming on the filling and superimposed load on the filling. So, now we will talk one by one, the loads, dead load. This loads coming on the structure due to self weight of its various structural components. Live load is due to surcharge due to stored and stacked materials. They are general cargo, bulk cargo, containers. Loads from vehicular traffic, it can include trucks, trailers, railway, cranes, container handling equipment. First slide I have shown the container handling equipment and construction plant. They constitute the vertical live loads. The truck loading, this is given in IS 4651. There are two types of loads. One is called as IRC class. What is IRC? Indian Road Congress. Then you have uniformly vertical live load. So, depending on the classification of berth, we can classify the berth as passenger berth, bulk berth, container berth, cargo berth, heavy cargo berth, small boat berth, fishing berth. So, the truck loading is classified as class B, class A, class A, AA or 70R, B and B. It depends on the size of the truck. Bigger the truck, it goes to 70R loading. Smaller the size of the vessel, size of the truck, it goes to class B loading. It is given in IRC code and standard textbooks. Number of axles, the tire dimension and the load coming on each wheel, that is given. But this will govern the design. If it is a passenger berth, you have to take 1 ton per meter square. But to have some understanding of this load, the heaviest load for building is library. Library the loading is 400 to 500 kg per meter square, whereas for the berth it is 1000 kg per meter square, it is twice the load. Is it clear? Compared to a building, suppose we are sitting here and discussing, this building might have been designed for classroom 400 kg per meter square, whereas a passenger berth will be designed for 1000 kg per meter square. Bulk unloading and loading berth 1 to 1.5 tons per meter square, container bus 3 to 5 tons per meter square. You see 5 tons per meter square, it is much more than 500 kg per meter square, that is 10 times higher load we are designing. And then cargo berth is about 2.5 to 3.5. Then heavy cargo means the finished steel products, they are all heavy cargo berths, it can go up to 5. Sometimes we design even up to 10 tons per meter square, that is the amount of cargo for which you have to design. That means your berthing structure is much, much heavier than normal buildings. Then we have the crane loads. So, it comes from crane wheels and other mechanical handling equipment. we have to consider impact of 25%. What is impact? What do you understand by impact? When it will happen?
Railway, in the rail there is sudden impact load.
The accident takes place, impact takes place. That is one way. Another is, if you are dropping a, suppose a crane is lifting a cargo container itself and is dropping from a height, then also impact comes. And the impact may come from the wheel also. So we assume 25% as the impact for the wheel loads. When it is suddenly stopping and the wheel is moving, suddenly you apply a brake, then also impact will come. And two cranes are moving side by side, we assume 15%. It is because the crane operator, if he sees another crane nearby, he will not operate with high speed. Is it clear? In a berth only one crane is there, he will operate at his own speed, but two cranes are nearby, they will not operate at high speed. That is why they give 15% as the impact factor. The mobile harbor cranes, the load intensity is 22 tons per meter square. This you have to compare with what we have discussed earlier. What is that we have discussed? Normally container berths will have up to, cargo berths up to 5 tons per meter square. But if you have a mobile harbor crane, I will show the figure separately. Instead of wheel, it has pad. It will have 4 pads, 2 pads on the sea side and 2 pads on the land side. Each pad is 5.5 meter by 1.8 meter. The spacing of the base is 12.5 by 12.5 meters. The load is 22 tons per meter square in normal boom, and extreme position it is 23.5 tons per meter square. So this load also we have to consider if it is using a mobile harbor crane. Nowadays many people are using the mobile harbor cranes. So this is called as one typical crane, LHM 400. The weight of the crane is 390 tons, about 400 tons. It is to lift a cargo of 100 tons. If you want to lift about 100 tons, the weight of the crane required is 400 tons. So the total weight is 494. So it moves on a axle that is about 16 axles. Then it when it is operating, the 4 pads are lowered, all the tires are lifted up. That time only we have the maximum loading. So this shows the photograph of the mobile harbor crane. This is the crane with axles here and tires here, and it moves on these tires. It goes to a particular location, then it drops the pads. These are the 4 pads. Each pad size is 5.58 meter by 1.8 meter. The center to center distance between the pad is about 12.5 meters. This distance also is 12.5 meters. That is what is given here in this figure. Pad size is 5.5 by 1.8, support base is 12.5 by 12.5. So it moves on a truck, that is what is shown here on tires. This shows the close up view of the container crane moving on the rails. This is not a mobile harbor crane, it is called as a key crane. This one leg of the crane, so we have 2 wheels here. Like that we have assembly of 4 such units, so totally we have 8 wheels. Then we have the railway loads, then we have special loads like pipelines, conveyors, etc. Then we will discuss about these forces in a separate class, that is about the berthing force, mooring force, wave force, different types of wave force, current force, seismic force. I have given some classification here, but next week onwards I will be discussing about this. I already discussed how to calculate, so we will discuss about the various forces also in the next class, differential water pressure. So with this our load will be completed.